Have you started again, Anirudh? Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, all. Good afternoon. Thank you for the wishes. Thank you. So I think we can start now. let's start. In the last class, we started with the HTML and we did few tags. Let's continue with the HTML. I hope I am audible. So the first tag today we are going to do is the insert and delete tag. These tags will help you to reflect the changes into your content. So whatever content you post on the page, if you need to modify it or change something in that, what you can do is you can use these tags, insert and delete tag. Insert tag is basically used to show the new content which is inserted into your document. And delete tag is basically used to show the text that has been deleted from the text or that is not much relevant now. So let me show you an example. Okay, now see this. In this document, you see I have inserted a paragraph. P tag is for the paragraph, and where I have written the performance of the product was first, and worst is basically included in the delete tag. So I want to change this, which was posted earlier, that worst, the performance of a particular product was worst in some year. Now I want to change it to average. So now I have written delete, delete is your deleting the old text, del tag, closing of the del tag, and then I have inserted a new word in place of this, that is an average. So this word is inserted in between your insert tag, INS. See, these are the two tags which are used commonly. And there is one more tag, which is your S tag. S tag indicates that the something which is no longer relevant or accurate. So if you want to highlight something and you want that something which is which you want to show on your page that it is no longer relevant. On e-commerce website, you commonly see this, that this product was earlier, they were offering on this price. Now it is offered on this price. So for this, I have included the S tag. And inside the S tag, what I have written, the older price of a particular product, which is suppose $90,000. And now it is offered at $50,000. So once we save it, see the output of this. The performance of the product was worst is now striked out. It means that this is deleted. Worst is deleted. And average is inserted and it is shown as underlined that this is the change in this line. That the performance of the product is basically average in a particular year. And a product was offered earlier at this price, which was striked out, cancelled out, and now it is offered at this price. So using delete and insert tag, what you can do is you can reflect the changes to your content on the web page. Now I hope it is visible. I have increased the font size on the editor. You can see I'm explaining again that insert tag and delete tag is basically used to change the content on your page. So if I have written worst earlier, now I want to cancel it out and change it to average. So what I have done is I have inserted the worst word in the paragraph into the two tags, the delete tag, and I have inserted a new word in place of it, that is an average, and included it in the insert tab. So you can see the first line of the output, the performance of the product was worst, which is now cancelled out. And it is average now, which is underlined, showing it is newly inserted. Then I have told you about one more tag, that is S tag. This indicates that something which is no longer accurate or relevant, but you don't want to delete it. You want to keep this as the information for your users. So for this, what you can do is you can insert this in the S tag. Like for this, suppose I have included that some product was earlier offered on my web page with $90,000. So now the price has been changed and revised. So what I can do is I can include the older price into S tag. You can see here, I have inserted was $90,000 in the S tag, and now it only at $50,000 I am offering. So on the web page, you can see that was $90,000 was cancelled out, and now it is offered only at $50,000. See, it's not necessary that you want to include insert tag every time, but when you are deleting something, so it means that you want to replace it with something, right? So otherwise it will be cancelled out, and what you want to do the changes in your web page. So if you have to include something new, some new information into your web page, you can use the insert tag. So now, insert, delete, and S tag you have learned. So let's move further. Anirudh has already given you a brief about the lists. You have already done the list. So lists are basically of three types: numbered lists, bullet lists, and definition lists. Lists are of three types: numbered list, bullet list, and definition list. Now, what are numbered lists? Numbered lists are basically where we use the numbers. Like if you want to make a list of items, so you can give the numbers there. That each item will in the list will be number 1, 2, 3, 4, so on. And bullet list is basically where you are using the bullets to highlight your points. And third one is your definition list, that if you want to define a set of terms, so for one term the keyword is written and then you can write the definition, then another keyword is written and then the definition is defined. So for that we are using the definition list. Now we'll be seeing one by one. Let's see the 13th program. We'll be sharing all these codes with you also, so that you can go through with these and you can have more hands-on practical on it. You can try your own program. So here you can see that I have inserted in the body part the heading, which is your scrambled eggs. And inside that heading, I have written a paragraph that eggs are one of my favorite foods, or something that you want to write. Then another heading, that is ingredients. Now in the ingredients, I want to make a list. I told you that lists are of three types: numbered list, your list are of three types, numbered list, bullet list, and definition list. So numbered list is basically an ordered list where a particular ordered is followed. That is, first you have to do this, then you have to do this, then you have to do this. There you can use the numbered list, it look good. So while specifying the method for making anything, like here on this page I have given some method to cook the scrambled eggs. So for the method, I am using the numbered list, and for the ingredients, I am using the bullet list, that is unordered list. UL stands for unordered list. Unordered list ke liye hum kaun sa tag use kar rahe? Here we are using UL tag. So inside UL tag, whatever items that we want to write in the list, we write inside the LI tag, that is the list tag. You see here, LI is the list tag where I have written the ingredient that I need 2 eggs, then I need 1 tablespoon butter, then I need 2 tablespoon cream, or whatever items you want to include in the list. That is an unordered list, which will be basically using the bullets. So you can include in the UL tag. And inside the UL tag, to make the items in the list, you can use the list item tag, that is LI tag. So this is basically your unordered list. 2 eggs, 1 tablespoon butter, and 2 tablespoon cream are basically shown with the help of the bullets. And then comes the H2, that is another heading that I have created, which is the method. Now, to show the method, that first we have to do this, and then the next step, and so on. So for this, I have included the ordered list. In order to make an ordered list, numbered list, what you can do is you can include this in the OL tag. OL stands for ordered list. Ordered list. So OL is the ordered list tag. And inside this, whatever items you want to include in this list, you can include in the LI tag, that is the list item tag. All these tags needs the closing. So inside the ordered list tag, you have to include LI tag, and for every LI, you need to close it. So after every line, what we have done is we have closed it. Then comes the third type of list, that is your definition list. Definition list is basically used where you want to define the set of terms. So here, for definition list, we are using the DL tag, that is the definition list tag. Inside it, to specify the term for the definition, so DT tag is used. DT stands for define the term. So that a term is defined, then you can give the definition. So DT is for the term that you are going to define. Inside DL tag, DL is for creating the definition list. So first we include the DL tag, and inside this we include the DT tag to define a particular term. Here we are defining the sashimi. Then this tag is closed, DT tag is closed for first definition. Now we will open another tag to define this sashimi. So here, DD tag is open to give the definition of the term that we have given earlier. So here, DD is basically your defining the term which you have specified earlier. This term is defined with the DD. For every term, you need a DD tag, the definition tag. So here we have defined that term, sashimi, that is a sliced raw fish that is served with condiments. And then another term I have included in this is, that is your scale. So scale basically is defined as a device to accurately measure your weight of ingredients. Then another term you can include here . Any DT term you can include here. Suppose definition. And that can be defined. So you can include n number of items in the list. So here in this program, you can see we have created 3 types of list: unordered list, ordered list, and the definition list. To create unordered list, you have to include the list items into the UL tag first, and then every item should be included between the list item tag. Then to create an unordered list, ordered list, you have to include all the items in the OL tag. OL stands for ordered list. And every item in the OL tag should be included in the LI. That is your list item tag. To create a definition list, you have to include every item in the DL tag. That is your definition list tag. And inside it, the definition list tag, two tags are basically used. One is DT, another is your DD. DT stands for the term that you want to define. So inside DT, what we write? The term. And inside DD tag, we give the definition of the term specified above. I hope you got this. Then next, what we have done is you can do the nesting of your lists. Means inside one list, you can include other lists. For example, I have shown here that an unordered list is shown with UL tag. And inside it, I have listed two items here in the LI tag. And inside the LI tag pastries, I have included another list. That is with unordered list again inside the one item, that is pastries. So the inside pastries, another list will be created. So if we save this, and you can see the output of this. Now you can see here on the page, HTML page, you can see here at the top, first heading is shown, that is H1 heading that I have included. Then inside it, I have included a paragraph. Then another heading with ingredients. And inside ingredients, what I had done is I had included the unordered list. Unordered list are basically shown with the help of bullets. So all the bullets are shown here. 2 eggs, 1 tablespoon butter, and 2 tablespoon cream, and so on. How many items you want to include, that depends upon your recipe. Then comes the method, another heading, and inside that, what I have done is I have created a ordered list. Because it is ordered, so it is numbered actually. 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, so on. Then comes the definition list. So here, first the term is defined, and then the definition is given. Again, scale is the term, and then its definition is given. One by one, what I have done is I have included the 4 terms, and for these 4 terms, I have included the definition. Then at the bottom, I had shown you how we can make a nested list, means one list inside the other list. So what I have done is I have included one unordered list inside the another unordered list. So unordered list is there, which is shown with the help of a disk bullets. And inside the pastries, I have created another unordered list here. You can see. So this is basically the nesting of your lists. I hope this is clear how we have done the nesting of the list. I hope I am audible. Okay. So till now, what we have read is that how we can create the list of items. The lists are of basically 3 types: ordered, unordered, and your definition list. For ordered list means they are numbered, and unordered means they are based on the bullets. And the third one is your definition list, where we want to define any term, set of terms, we will be basically using your definition list. So let's move further. And let's learn how we can create the links. what are the purpose of creating link? Now, in your website, when you want to link to different websites or different pages, you need to specify the web address of that particular page or a website you want to refer to. So how we can do that? Now, there are two types of addresses that we can specify here. While dealing with the links, there are two types of addresses that we can specify. The very first type of address is basically your absolute address. Now, if you are accessing any other website by staying in your website, then you have to specify the absolute link, means absolute address, the full address where there is where you have to mention the domain name. So that is your absolute address. And when you are accessing or when you are linking to other pages of the same site, that is your own site, and when you are linking those pages with the help of hyperlinks, so in that case, there is no need to specify the absolute address. You can refer it with the relative URLs. Means the domain names are not mandatory to be mentioned. So now we'll learn here the three things that when we link to a different website, or for this, what we are using is we are basically specifying, we are using here the A tag with href attribute. This Anirudh has already told you briefly, so we'll be doing hands-on on this also. So that in order to have links on your web page, we'll be using A tag, and the href attribute of A tag basically specifies that which page you want to link to. In the href attribute, what we specify is the page we want to link to. That is the URL of the page we want to link to. So that URL could be an absolute URL if you are linking to another website, or that URL could be your relative URL if you are accessing your own website. Now, let's see. We'll also learn about the email link. You can see here what I have written is in the example. A is the tag to anchor. Anchor means to link to some other place. Now, A tag has an attribute href, hyper referencing, that this page is linked to some other page when you will click onto it. So inside the hyper reference tag attribute, what I have written, its value is basically your URL. This is basically a complete URL where I am specifying the domain name, that is google.com. And if a specific page on that website I want to refer to, so I will write after google.com/ the page that I am referring to. And then this href attribute should be specified in the opening tag, that is the A opening tag. Then the term that I want to become, to act as a link, that when the user click on a particular term, then that page will be open. So inside the A tag, we mention the text or a term which acts as a hyper referencing link. So here refer is acting as that. So when we click onto the refer, so it will link me to the google.com page here. Then A tag is closed. A is your anchor tag. Now, browsers basically show your links in the blue and underlined form. So whatever links you will create into your page, browsers by default show it in the blue color and underlined form. So let's see an example. Okay. Let me show you the code first. Now here you can see the program where I have included different links. So if you see here, what I have done is inside the body tag, I have included a paragraph, or you can include a heading also here, linking to other sites. I have included an unordered list here because I want to include multiple hyperlinks here. So I have included it in the form of links, so it will look neat. So every item in the list is included in the LI tag, that is the list tag. And inside the list tag, what I have done is I have included the anchor tag and the hyper referencing attribute, href attribute of your anchor tag. Now inside this, I had given here the absolute URL that when I click onto the word Google, which is basically acting as a linking text, then I will link my page to the google.com. When I click onto Yahoo, I link to the yahoo.com. When I click onto the small PDF, I link to the small PDF.com. And then W3 schools pe click kare to w3schools.com par humko leke jayega. So here I have included 4 links in the unordered list. Now this list is basically including all the tags that are using the href values are basically using the absolute URL, because I'm linking to some other website here. I'm not linking it with my own website pages. Here I'm linking to some other website. So let's see the output of this first. You can see the output of this. Here you can see linking to other sites. The first list is basically we are linking our page to the other website. So when I click on to google.com, so it has linked me to the google.com web page, that is the another website. And similarly, if I click onto the Yahoo, it will link me to the yahoo.com website. So the first list is basically showing you that we can connect our web pages to the outside world with the help of your hyperlinks. That is, with the help of creating links. Now, the other list I have also included here, which is basically showing you that if we want to create a link to other pages on the same site, how we can do it. Here, there is no need to specify the absolute URL. The relative URL means the file name will actually work, because generally we keep all the pages at one place. So there is no need to specify here the URL, just the absolute URL, only the relative URL is required. So here I have created another list, unordered list, and inside unordered list, in the list item tag, I am using the anchor tag with href value as home.htm. This is the page of the same site which I am creating. Then similarly, if I have another pages like about us page, movies page, contact information page, so I can use these as a hyperlinks. So I can link to the same pages, the same website, by referencing like this. Now if you see the output here, linking to the other pages on the same site. So here I have used the relative URL. Once you click onto the home page, I have not written any text on the home page. I have just created a dummy page, home page, where I had given the again the hyper referencing to the back to that same page. So when I click onto the home page, so it is giving me a text which is acting as a hyperlink to link to the original page. So I click here, I'll come back. You can include any type of text in your home page that you want to create. So till now you have learned two types of URLs, that is absolute URL, specifying absolute URL, and the relative URL. You can link your page to different website, or you can link to other pages of the same site. So if you are linking outside your website, then you have to specify the absolute URL, complete domain name. And if you are linking to your own website, the same website, then there is no need to specify the domain name. Now next, we are going to learn about the email links. Email links. It starts up user's email program. So when we are creating an email link with the help of an anchor tag, we need a special attribute known as mail to attribute, which will basically use to link to the user's email program. So for this, let's see an example. Okay. Here. Let's see this. Now inside the body tag, what we have done is we have included the anchor tag, and inside the anchor tag, the href attribute whose value is equal to, see what we have written in the double quotes, you have to specify the value, and before the actual value for the email, what we have written here is mail to. So this will help the browser to open the application related to your email program. That is what we have written, mail to colon. Then we have specified the email address. That is whatever email address you can specify here. So I have specified my own email address here, sakshisani.u@gmail.com. Now, the text which will act as a hyper-referencing, that is the link, connect to Sakshi Taresh, that is my name. Then anchor tag is closed. So you can see here the mail to tag. This will basically create an email link which starts the user email program. Now let me show you the output for this. Okay, now you can see here. See, the text which is acting here as the hyperlink is connect to Sakshi Taresh Khanna. So this is basically an email link. When I click onto this, this will basically open an email application. Whatever type of application you want to start with, you can click on. So that application will be started, and by default it will link to the email address which I have specified inside the href value. And another information it is showing here that we are going to learn next in our program, that is how we can open a particular link in a new window. Because if you see, whatever hyperlinks I have created, they all are opened in the same window. So for this, I need to click back button to come back to the original page. So if I want that my link should be opened in a new window, so how we can do this work is by using the same anchor tag, that is a tag, and its href attribute. Href attribute now should have the value for href kisko refer karta hai, the page we want to open. So inside the double quotes, what we have given is, we have given the, suppose our own college website address, that is the URL, rlacollege.edu.in. So I want whenever I click onto a particular text, so my web college website will open, but it should open in the new window. So for this, what I have written here is, another attribute of the anchor tag, that is target. Target's value should be underscore blank. So this will help you to open a particular web, a particular link in the fresh window, that is your new window. So if you specify target is equal to underscore blank, so your link will be open in a fresh window. The text which acts as a hyperlink is specified here as Ramlal Anand College. Then anchor tag is closed. When I save it and run this, you see here in the output. Now, when I click on to Ramlal Anand College, it will link me to the Ramlal Anand College website and it has opened in a new page. This is my older page, parent page, and this is my child page, which is opened in a new window. Earlier, it was opening in the same page, same window. Now it has opened in the fresh window, that is the new window. I hope this is clear that how we can create the hyperlinks and how we can create the email links. And then we have learned how we can open a link in a new window with the help of an attribute of the anchor tag, that is the target, whose value should be, in the double quotes we write, underscore blank. Now, another type of link we can also create, which will help you to link from one part of the page to the another. Means within the same page, we can make links. So we'll also see here how to link to a specific part on the same page. By staying on the same page, we can link to the bottom and then bottom to the top and so on like that. So let's see an example here. Yes, we'll be giving you all these codes along with the source code and the files, HTML files, and the little tutorial document that I'm referring to. So you will be able to practice on your own also. So let's open the next example that we have created for you here. Yeah. Now, how we can link from one specific part of the document on the same page to the another specific part of the document. For this, what we'll be using is, here you can see I have created an heading with the name Film Genos. Now here in the heading tag, H1 tag, there is an attribute called ID. So there is an attribute called ID. You can see here, let me tell you one thing here, that we can use H1 element and its ID attribute to specify the parts of the page. What we are giving is basically, we are dividing the page into different parts. And we are specifying an identifier for every part. So ID is nothing but an identifier for every part of the page. So this ID is basically an attribute that we specify in the opening tag of H1 heading. Then we are also using here, because this we are creating a hyperlink, hyper-referencing here. So href attribute we'll be using to contain the URL or the address where we want to jump to. Now, because we are staying on the same page, so whatever value here we specify, so that value should have the hash symbol in the beginning. The hash symbol in the beginning. And hash symbol will be followed by the value of the ID to which I want to link. जो भी आईडी है आपकी, जिस आईडी के साथ आप उसको लिंक करना चाहते हो, उस जिस पार्ट पर आप स्विच करना चाहते हो, सो यू विल स्पेसिफाई हियर विथ हैश एंड दैट आईडी एट्रीब्यूट्स वैल्यू. नाउ लेट्स सी हियर इन द 16th. यस, यू सी हियर वी हैव क्रिएटेड एन हेडिंग, H1 हेडिंग, एंड दिस इज आइडेंटिफाइड विद सपोज टॉप. Now this part of the document is identified with an identifier top, and for this I have given the name FilmGeners. And inside it, what I have written is I have created an anchor tag, and in the href value, it is the hyper referencing value. In the double quotes, what I have given here is hash action, and then the text which will act as the hyperlink. So here let me differentiate so that you can understand better. Let me write it in the capital so that you can differentiate between the two words. Okay. So in the href, what I have written is hash symbol, which is followed by the ID value. Action is the ID value. That when I click on to this action word, then where I will link to? I will link on to the same. Now I hope it is clear. I have increased the font. So when I click on to the action word, so where I am linked to, I will be linked to some other part on the same page. But where is that part? That is basically specified by this identifier, which I have written followed by hash action. Wherever it will find this action as the identifier, then it will link me to that particular part of the page. So for this, we have created different headings specifying these as action, comedy, and horror as the identifiers. So here you can see I have created a heading, this, where the ID attribute has the value action. So when I click onto the action, it will link me to the this heading. And another heading I have created with the ID value comedy. So whenever I click onto this hyper reference link, comedy, then it will link me to this paragraph, the comedy paragraph. And similarly, we have created it for horror also. So in the hyper referencing tag, if we are specifying hash followed by the identifier, it means that we are linking within the same page. One part of the document is linked to the other part of the document. So whenever I will click onto the action word, so it will link me to the identifier that I have mentioned here, that is the hash action. So hash action should be there. So if you see here, the H2 heading has an identifier with the name action. So when I click onto the capital action wala word, then it will link me to the H2 heading. When I click onto the comedy, so this will find out the hash comedy, that is your identifier comedy. Here it is. So it will link me here. And so on like this. Now at the bottom, what I have done is, I have created another hyperlink with the anchor tag href with the value hash top. So where is this top identifier? I had given the first heading, H1 heading, as the FilmGeners. And this will act as a top identifier because here I have specified that its identity is top. So whenever at the bottom of the page, when I click onto the top, so it will link me to the FilmGeners at the top. So let us see the output for this. Save this as .html and then let's see the output. Here you can see the page appears like this, where at the top we have the film genres and the three types of film genres we have specified here: action, comedy, and horror. So when I click on to the comedy, this will link me to the comedy part of the page. Since this is a big page, so I have linked, I have created an hyperlink comedy. When I click onto the comedy, it will search for hash comedy. That is the identifier. Where is the identifier? So when I have created this heading, comedy heading, inside this I have specified that ID is hash comedy. So it has linked me to this part. Now if you see here in the bottom of the page, I have created another link with the top. So when I click onto the top, it will search for the top identifier. So while creating a heading, H1 heading, that is film genres, I have used the identifier as top. So it has linked me to the top of the page, that is your film genres. So when I click onto the horror, this will link me to the horror part of the page that has the paragraph written for the horror. So now you have learned the three types of link. One, to link to a other website. Another, how we can link to the other pages of the same website. Third, how we can create email links. And fourth is basically how we can link one part of the document with the another part of this document on the same page. So four types of link you have read in this example, in this section. Now, let's move forward. I hope this is clear to all how we can create these four types of links. This is very important part of the page. When you have big pages, then you can use this hash ID concept to link the one part of the document to the another part. I hope this is clear. So we can proceed further. Now, you can see here again that while specifying the H1 heading, inside the heading tag, we specify the ID value, that is the identifier value. And in the hyperreference tag, we use that identifier to link to a particular part of the page. We'll be moving forward. Well, let's learn about the tables. In this section, we are going to learn about how we can create tables or how we can represent information in a tabular format. So let's learn how to create tables first. In order to create tables in an HTML file, tables are basically written out row by row. So first, you have to first specify first row, then second row, and then the third row. So for this, we'll be using the table tag, which is basically used to create tables. And inside this, we'll be using tr, that is tr tag, to create the rows. Tr is table row. Then we'll specify the cell data, the table data value, with the help of TD tag. In order to give a heading to a particular row or a column, we use the TH tag. Let's see a simple example how we can create a table in the HTML. So you can see here, you can see in this program, in the body tag, first of all, in order to create a table, I have written a table tag, and inside it, the row, first row, that is the TR. This TR will become as the first table row. Now, what all values I'm specifying in that row is 20, 25 and 35. Every value that you want to specify in one row should be included in the TD, that is the table data, cell data. Then when you are over with your first row, close it. Then open another row with the help of TR tag. Then whatever values you want to insert in the TR tag, specify it in the TD, that is the table data, that is cell data. Then when you are over with your second row, close it, and so on, how many rows you want to create. Then TR again for the third row and TD for specifying the your data, table data or cell data. Once I am over with creating all the rows and the data inside the row, then close the table tag. Inside the table tag specifies that we are creating a table and these are the rows for that particular table. So when we will save it and run this, now let's open this file in the browser. So here you can see this type of structure will appear. I have not specified any heading here. I have just included the rows and the cell values. So when I will open this in the browser, I have opened it in the browser. So you can see every row is specified here. 20, 25, 35 was the first row. 45, 60, 45 was the second row. And 70, 80 and 90 was the third row. So wherever you want to include your data in this form, you can use the table tag, and inside the table tag you can create table rows with the help of TR tag. And for every row, when you have to specify the values, you can use the TD tag, that is the table data tag. I hope this is clear how to create a table. Next we are going to see that if let us suppose your values in a particular cell, in a particular value that is greater than the one cell, so you can increase the width of that cell with the help of specifying the span, that how much this value will span. That is, you can specify the column span or the row span. For this, we can use the two attributes. The call span attribute, which specifies how many columns that cell should run across, ki wo wala column aapka wo wala cell jo hai wo kitne columns mein aayega, and the row span, how many rows that cell runs across, kitne rows mein particular value aayega. These two attributes, call span attribute and the row span attribute, should be included in the TD tag, that is the cell tag, that is the table data. So because when you are specifying the value, then that value will be spanned in a particular column or in two columns or in three columns or in two rows. So these two attributes, call span and the row span attribute, should be included in the TD, that is your table data. So let's see an example how we can use call span and row span. For this, we are looking at one example. Okay, now you can see in this, let me first explain you the body part, then I'll be coming to the head part where I have included a little CSS here. Now in the body part, you can see I have included a table tag. This table tag is comprising of the first row, where the first heading I have kept as empty. I have opened the heading tag. TH tag is basically used for the table heading. So now for this row, I am putting first heading as empty. I have not written anything inside this tag. So it means that this is containing no value. First heading will be empty. Now second heading, th, again in the second column, second heading will be 9 a.m. and the heading tag is closed. For the third heading, table heading, 10 a.m. and then it is closed, and then 11 a.m. and then 12 a.m. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 columns will be created for the headings, where first will not contain any value and the rest all will have values like 9 a.m., 10 a.m., 12 a.m. and 12 p.m. and so on. So first row I have closed. So first row is closed here. Then I have opened the second row, where I had given the row heading th, which has the value Monday. When you see your timetable, at the top row you have the timings like 9 a.m. to 10 a.m., 10 a.m. to 11 a.m. and so on like that. On the first column you see Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, your days of the week. So for this I am creating this. I have created another row with the heading Monday. So in the second row, Monday will be shown, and TD to specify the value in that row, I have used TD here, and that columns, and I have written here the attribute column span. What does column span says? Column span specifies how many columns that cell should run across. How many columns that cell should run across. The particular value that I am specifying here is Python. So if let us suppose on Monday, I want to specify the first class as Python and second class also as Python. So that means that should be appearing in the two columns. So for this, I have written here the attribute call span whose value is equal to 2. Means the Python value will span across two columns. What does that mean? The Python value should span across the two columns. Then I have closed the TD tag to specify here that this is over with the first value in that particular row. Now the next value is TD. Again, dusri value dene ke liye usi row mein, I have used TD tag again. Then computer networks, and then it is closed. I have not specified column span here. So by default, it will be specified only in the single column. Then the third column, word processing. And that row is over for the Monday. Monday we have four classes, two classes for Python, one for computer networks and another for word processing. Then comes for the next row. Next row is for the next day, that is Tuesday. So table heading I have specified here as Tuesday. So next row will be starting with the Tuesday. And inside that Tuesday row, I have created TD for specifying the value that column span is equal to 3. Means Python will span first three columns. Then another last column will be specified with the computer networks. So when I save and run this, document.html. So you can see here. When I open this in the browser, you can see here on Monday, Python is basically spanned in the two columns. See here, 9 a.m. and 10 a.m. column. This is specified in the two columns. And similarly, on Tuesday, I had given Python the span of three columns. So it is spanned in the three columns. So in this way, you can increase the span of a particular value with more than one column. And you can also use the row span to show here that it is specified in more than one row. So if I, let us suppose, want to show you that, say, let us include here TR tag for another row, and let's give that row a heading as Wednesday. Let's close this heading, and inside that row, I want to specify the value. Now I am taking a row span here, instead of columns par, now I'm specifying that this value will take two rows. So its value should be given in the double quotes equal to row span equal to double quotes mein. Jitni value doge, utne rows mein wo aayegi value. So let us suppose any value, suppose programming. Okay, now this is closed. And let us suppose another value that I want to give in this. Graphics, then this is closed. Another value, WPP, that is closed. 1, 2, 3. Okay, now I can close this row. And then the table is closed. Let's save it and open it again in the browser. Yes, all right. And when you will open the same file in the browser, because I have not specified the fourth row here, so row span dekhne ke liye utni rows bhi to honi chahiye. So let me copy paste this. Instead of Wednesday, let's make this as Thursday. Now you can see here on Wednesday I have specified that the programming paper will be spanned in two rows. So now it has spanned in two rows here on Wednesday and Thursday. You can see here that it is spanned in the two rows, and the values earlier specified is spanned in the three rows or two columns like that. So now you have learned that how we can specify, or when we are drawing a table in which you want to specify one value which spans in more than one column or one row, you can do this with the help of call span and row span attribute. I hope this is clear. Let's move forward. So we'll be we close the open files. Okay. Let's continue. Now, to distinguish between the contents of the table, that this is the main content of the table, and this is the first row of the table, and this is the last row of the table, what we can do is we can use different tags here. T head tag, T body tag, and T foot tag. T head is for specifying the table headings. T body is to specify the main content of the table. And T foot is basically for the table footer. So you can specify the parts of the table like this: main body in T body, then heading and footer in the T head and T foot. So this is basically used with very long tables, which spans more than one page. So for this, let's see an example of T head, T body, and T foot. Okay. You can see here how we have done this. Now, inside the body tag, you can see table, table tag, and T head is used to specify the table heading. So inside the T head tag, I have created one row that contains the three headings: date, active patients, and recovered patients. So this will be our first row, which will act as a table heading that contains date, active patients, and recovered patients. Then this row is closed and the head part is closed. Table head is closed. Now I am coming to the main body of the table, with where we are. I have created many rows that contains the data for the month of January. That on 1st January, these were the active patients and these were the recovered patients. So inside this T body, the first row, TR, the heading for the first row, values for the first row, that is your 1st January. Then value is 250 for the active patients and 36 is for the recovered patients. First row is closed. Then for the second row, 2nd January, then the two values for the active and the recovered patients. Then second row is closed. And so on, I have created many rows here. Then you see here, I have created a long table here. Now at the bottom, when I am over with the table body part, the main body part, then I have created a footer, PR, with some values. Let us suppose that are the total values for the patients admitted and recovered. So this row is closed, footer is closed. Then I am over with the table part, so I have closed the table tag here. Now when I will save this and run this, open it in the browser. You see here, this type of table will appear where date, active patients will act as a heading for the table, and the main body of the table starts from 1st January and so on, and then comes the footer. So after the table heading, a line is shown, and after the main body of the table, before the footer, table footer, a ruler is shown here. So you can create this type of table with the help of your T head, T body, and your T foot tag. This will basically help you to segregate the table heading and the main body of the table with the footer. So this will look more clear when you will use table head, table body, and table footer with the long tables. Now, I would also like to show here. Okay, let's move further. Then I'll be coming to the CSS part. Then I will explain this. I have included a little CSS in this. I'll be explaining this little ahead. So let's move ahead and see what we can do with the HTML more. Now let's learn about the forms, how we can create forms to collect the information from the visitors, or what are the different types of form controls that we can include. There are different types of form controls that are there. I think everybody has seen the Google homepage. Google homepage, which is the basic form that comprises of a search box, which sits in the middle of the page. Right? So Google form, the forms are basically used extensively in the websites. When you search anything, you open the browser and you type google.com, homepage will open, and that is an example of your form. Then when you go for any registration online, then you see the forms. Shopping online, you see the forms. Signing up for a particular email, you will get a signing up on any website, you get a form there. So let's see how we can create forms and we can add the form controls on the page. So let's start. We can add the text into the form. Text input, which is basically used to add a single line, like your email or your name. We can include the text input box. Password input, where you can enter a single line of text, but that is masked. Means you can't see the characters. You cannot see the characters. Text area to get messages from the users or comment from the users. Means which is longer than the single line. Then you can have different type of controls on the forms, like your buttons, radio buttons, check boxes, drop down menus. So you can include all these buttons in the form. Then submit buttons to submit the data. Differentiate between different pieces of information that is given into the form. The information is sent in the form of name value pair. So यहाँ पर आपके पास जो भी इंफॉर्मेशन फॉर्म पे सेंड होती है वो नेम वैल्यू पेयर की फॉर्म में जाती है, यानी उसमें दो चीजें होती है, नेम ऑफ एन फॉर्म कंट्रोल एंड द वैल्यू फॉर दैट फॉर्म कंट्रोल. टू क्रिएट फॉर्म्स, फॉर्म एलिमेंट इज बेसिकली यूज्ड, फॉर्म टैग इज यूज्ड. इट हैज थ्री मेन एट्रीब्यूट्स. फॉर्म जब भी बनता है उसमें थ्री एट्रीब्यूट्स होते हैं. First attribute is the action attribute, that is basically containing the value, that is the URL for the page on the server. Server पे server का URL आप यहाँ पे दोगे कि भाई action हो जब form में information submit होते कहाँ जाए, जो इस information को receive करेगा. So that is the action. Then the next attribute is the method. Form can be sent using one of the option, that is get or post. So two methods are there, get method and the post method. Get method ke sath kya hota hai? With get method, the values from the form are added to the end of the URL specified in the action. Get ke andar jo bhi aap values specify karte ho, wo sari values kahan chali jati hai? URL ke aage aage lagti jati hai. Agar aap dekhoge kabhi bahut bada URL aa raha hai kahin se, to usme aage aage uski form ki attributes ki values lagti ja rahi hai, form controls ki value lagti ja rahi. So this method is basically used for short forms, when you are creating small forms that contains little information from the user. So this type of method is used when we are dealing with the short forms, small forms. Post method, in this a separate HTTP header is created to send this type of information. This is generally used when we are dealing with the long forms, means that contains a lot of data, or when we are transmitting some information which is sensitive. We don't want it to be included in the URL. So you can use that type of data. When you are uploading files with the help of forms, you will use the post method. Now let's see an example how we can create a form. You can see here. This is a simple form that we have created. Inside the body, you can see here, we have a form action, form tag, and the first attribute is your action. What action it should take. Means, ye data kaun receive karega? Who is the receiver of this data, which is basically sent in this form? So let us suppose I have here added http www.ictacademy.in and suppose uske login page pe ye information receive. So maine yahan par koi URL dal diya which will act as a receiver for this information. Then inside it I have created a paragraph which will specify the username, and to take the username from the user, what I have written here, I have written the input tag. Input tag will basically help you to accept the information, to take the input from the user. Now the value of the input tag type, the type that we are specifying here is the that what type of information we are accepting in this input, that we are accepting only text input here. So value is text here. So type attribute specifies what type of information we are specifying here. This is the text here. So whatever data it will accept is in the form of a text only. The name of this form control, all the form controls should have a name. So the name of this form control is user name. This name is sent to the server so that the browser will be able to locate where this has to be linked. Then the size, that is the size of the text input, that it is basically accepting the 15 characters, and the maximum characters that it can accept up to 30. So 15 or 30, up to maximum length is 30. So it will not stop you till 15. If you will specify size as 15 and not specify the maximum length, then it will accept only 15. So if you'll specify here the maximum length, so it will extend up to 30 characters. After 30 characters, it will not allow you to enter more text here. Then this is closed. Then another paragraph is opened with the title password. Then input type is equal to password. Now what type of input it will accept? It will be of password type, text and password. So earlier for the username, we have entered here the value as text, and now we have entered it as the password. So automatically it will be masked now. You will not be able to see what character you have entered. Then the name of this form control is password. Size is again, I have specified the same 15 to 30 characters. Now, if you want that you want to take some comments from the user that how did you find this particular page or website, then you have to include it. You will not be able to accept a long data in the text input. Why? Because it will be allowing you only to accept a single line of data. In order to have more data from the user, what you can do is you can include a text area, which is basically used to create multi-line text input. With the help of text area, this text area tag, you can accept multiple line text input from the user. It will create a text area box where the user can enter the data that could be of more than one line. The name of that particular text area is equals to comment. Suppose, because text area is also a form control, so for this name is, let us suppose I have given here comments, and I have to specify here how long the text area should be. So for specifying the size, what is the attribute here? Calls, how many columns should it take on the screen? 10 columns. And for rows, I have specified 4 rows. So in 10 columns and 4 rows, user can specify the comments. So you can specify any size here. If you want a bigger text area, you can increase this size from 10 to 4. You can increase the rows, number of rows to 10 or columns to 20, whatever you want to. Then I had given here text here that enter the comments, and then the text area will be shown. So when I will save it and open this file in the browser, see what happens. Now you can see this type of form I have created, where I have given username, password, and I'm asking to the user, what do you think about this website? Now here I'm including the text area. The first two, username and password, are the basically simple text inputs, which will allow user to enter a single line up to 30 characters. And the last one is, last box is basically specifying the text area, where it is of 10 columns and 4 rows. So this will accept the data from the user in 10 columns and 4 rows. So we can write here anything like this. And password, any password. We can write any data here. So
more than one lines can be entered into the text area. So now you have understood how we can create a simple form which comprises of the username password with that has a text input, and how we can include a text area into our web page. Now we will learn how we can add different types of buttons. Here on this page, we have not included any button. Now we will learn how we can add buttons. So let's see. This I have already explained to you. Now buttons are of different types. Radio buttons, check boxes, drop down list, or you can have an option for including uploading a file, or you can include an image button also. So in order to include a button, let's see an example here. Let me explain you all types of buttons one by one. Now see here, inside the body tag, we have included the form tag here. This form tag, we are specifying the action which contains the URL of the server that accepts this information. And at the end, we are specifying the method that we are using. We are using the post method. Then one line I have written, please select your favorite music genre. Now, inside it, I am giving the option to the user with the help of radio buttons. So I'm asking user that please select your favorite music genre. So out of these values, that I'm specifying, user will select one, and then basically choose the option. So in order to specify, in order to give the radio button there, what I am doing it here as input type, input tag to take the input from the user. Then type is equals to what type of button we want to create, that is the radio button. The name of this form control we have given as, suppose, Jenner, and the value for every radio button. So because whatever information the form control sends is in the name value pair, so name is given here as Jenner, and the value for this particular radio button is, suppose, wrap. So when a user clicks onto it, selects this option, chooses this option, so this name value pair is sent to the server. Then another attribute is used, that is checked. Post value is equal to checked means that by default, when you will open this page, so this value will be shown as selected. So any value if you want to be shown as selected, so you can write in that input type the attribute checked, and whose value is equal to checked means that by default it will be shown as selected. Then the name of the type, that is input type, that is your wrap will be shown along with the radio button. Then another input type, that is radio, second radio button with the name value pair, and value shown besides the radio button is pop. Then the third radio button contains the value jazz. Now, in order to create a radio button, the input tag is used and its attribute type is equals to radio. Type is equals to radio. Name is the value, name contains the value, name attribute contains the value which is sent to the server. Value जो भी आप रेडियो बटन को जिसके साथ एसोसिएट करना चाह रहे हो वो आप उसकी वैल्यू रख सकते हो. एंड देन द टेक्स्ट जो आपका रेडियो बटन के साथ अपीयर होगा, दैट इज रैप, पॉप, जैज इन माइक एग्जांपल. चेक्ड एट्रीब्यूट सेज दैट बाय डिफॉल्ट दिस ऑप्शन विल बी शोन एज चेक्ड, मींस सिलेक्टेड. यू कैन चेंज दिस ऑप्शन इफ यू वांट टू, यूजर कैन चेंज दिस. देन सी द नेक्स्ट टाइप ऑफ बटन दैट आई हैव इंक्लूडेड इज योर चेक बॉक्स. इन ऑर्डर टू क्रिएट अ चेक बॉक्स यू कैन स्पेसिफाई हियर इनपुट tag and the attribute type is equals to checkbox, type is equals to checkbox, name is equals to actor I have given here because I am specifying here actor values that you got to select from the your favorite actors. The list is I am specifying. So values would be Shah Rukh Khan, Salman Khan, Tiger Shroff or anything that you want to include. Then this will help you to create check boxes, three check boxes with the name Shah Rukh Khan, Salman Khan or Tiger Shroff. So you can choose, the user can choose any value. Inside the first check box, I have given the attribute check is equal to check, which means that by default, this will be shown as selected. Then next is your how we can include a drop down menu. How we can include a drop down menu. So for this, we are using here the select tag. Select tag. In order to create a drop down menu, we use the select tag. Then inside the select tag, there is an attribute name. Name for that tag. Then size that specifies basically the size of the number of items that you are specifying inside that drop down. If I make it 5, it means that I'm including 5 values in the drop down. So multiple, next attribute is the multiple attribute, which is whose values is equal to multiple, means that user is allowed to select multiple values from this. Then the option to specify the options inside the drop down, that is option and value is equals to any value, that is laptop, FM radio, mobile phones. What I am asking the user is to select where you want to listen the songs, on your laptop, on your FM radio or on mobile phones. So these three options will appear in my drop down. Then select tag is closed. So with the help of this select tag and the option tag, what we have created, the drop down menu. Then if you want user to upload any file, so you can see here I have written upload your list of songs, favorite songs ki list aap upload karo. So what I have written here, input tag is used whose type is now what? File. Whose type is file. The name of this control, form control, is user list. Then when the user has uploaded a file, so it has to be submitted. So I have here included input type equal to submit. So this will help me to add a submit button there. So input type is equal to submit will have allow me to add a submit button there. And the value of this control submit button is suppose upload. This value will be shown on the button upload. So on the button, what will be written? Upload. So when the user click onto this button, this file will be uploaded on whatever server you are linking to. So let's save this and see the output. see this. You can see here a type of form is created where on the top we have radio buttons, then check boxes, then drop down, then option for the file uploading, and then again a text box with a button titled as subscribe. So here there is a radio button. By default, the first radio button is selected. Because I have written in the first radio button the checked attribute, and whose value is checked means by default that value is selected. So you can change it if you want. Then by default, first checkbox is also selected because I have written their checked attribute. You can change it what if you want to, or you can select multiple options in the checkboxes that will allow you to select. You can unselect previous one, or you can select two. Select where you want to listen the song. Suppose on my mobile phone. So select this from the drop down. Then if you want to upload any file, so there is an option that you can choose your file. It will allow you to choose from your machine. You can choose any file and then upload it. There is an upload button. I hope this is clear how we can create form and how we can include the buttons in it. Different types of buttons we have learned: radio buttons, check boxes, drop down, and option for uploading the file. I hope this is clear. Okay. Now, let's move on to another example where I'm going to show you how to label the form elements. See, we have to link it to the server. There we can send the file that is uploaded on the server. So right now we don't have any server. You can create any server and you can upload the file on that server. So now let's learn how we can label the form controls. How we can label the form controls. Each form control should have a label element. For this, we are using the label tag. Now, label element can be used in two ways. You can wrap around both the text and the form input, or you can kept it separate from the form control. And with if you are using the second option, then you have to use the for attribute. Let's see an example, then it will be clear to you. See here. Now you can see here in the body, I have created a form tag. Action is equals to the value which specifies the URL of the server, which is basically the recipient of this information. Then a label tag. Inside the label tag, what I have written is what is your age. Then input type is equals to text and name is equals to age. So I'm asking the age from the user. So for that, I have created a text box where I'm expecting the text and whose name is equals to age. Then the label is closed. So this is your first element, which is label. Now, then I'm asking the user to enter the gender. Now, input tag is used and the labels are identified. Identifiers are given that this ID is equals to female and the type is equals to radio button. to accept the gender, I'm creating the radio buttons. The name of this particular control is gender. Label for is the attribute, equals to female. Then this means that this input is labeled or linked with this, because ID is equal to female is specified here, and in the for I am referring this as the ID. For is equals to ID. For attribute is basically used to indicate which form control it is labeled for. It is a label for. क्योंकि आपके पास एक से ज्यादा फॉर्म कंट्रोल्स हो सकते हैं, तो आप किसके साथ इसको लेबल करना चाहते हैं? जो आपकी स्क्रीन पे आपको दिख रहा है, जो रेडियो बटन्स दिख रहे हैं, वो बहुत सारे हैं. इट मींस डिफरेंट फॉर्म कंट्रोल्स आर देयर, सो विद विच यू वांट टू लेबल इट. सो आई वांट टू लेबल दिस विद दिस फीमेल विद व्हाट द आइडेंटिफायर दिस फीमेल. सो दिस इज हाउ इट इज लिंक्ड विद द हेल्प ऑफ फॉर एट्रिब्यूट. So whatever value I write it in the for, it will linked with that particular form control. That is this input box. Then next input ID is equal to male, type is radio button, and the name is gender. Value is equals to M. Then with which form control it is labeled to? It is labeled to the form male. ID is whose ID is male. So for is equals to identifier. This identifier I have written in the form control, this one. So this label is related with this. So where it is written male, so whatever value user will enter, this will be linked to the input ID male, which is this radio button. So when you will run this, you can see the first text box appears here, whatever information I'm writing here, and the two labels appear here, female and the male. These are the two labels. The female is basically linked with this radio button, and male value is linked with this radio button. So user can select any one of these, and internally it is properly labeled. So now you have learned how we can label different form controls with the help of an identifier. So in the label, we can give that identifier, and that label will be automatically linked with that particular form control. Next, we will learn how we can group related form elements together. If we have different form elements present, how we can group them together? To group the form elements together, we need a tag known as field set. Field set. This will help to create a field, and where we can include the related form elements. The related form elements, many of the browsers basically show a line around the field set, that this is a group of elements, they are together. So they will be shown in a box. So this is very good when we are creating very long forms and we have some set of information which is related. For example, a form that contains personal information about the user, like name, address, phone number, that can be linked together in one part. And the information related to the qualification, like enter your graduation marks, post graduation marks, and so on, like that, in the one that can be grouped into another set, another field set. So this is basically used when we are using very long forms. And this will help you, field set will help you to group the related form elements. Now, The appearance of this can be adjusted by CSS. We can, when in the next class, we'll be going to learn about the CSS, how we can do all this, how we can control and we can make the form beautiful, colorful, and the size of every related elements, how we can change its size with the help of a CSS. Now let's see an example how we can do this. We are also going to use inside the field set, we'll be using legend tag that just comes after the field set tag to show that a caption which basically helps to identify the purpose of that group. For example, that I am asking you that suppose personal information is grouped together. So personal information is nothing but a legend for that particular group of fields. That will help the user to know that yes, this part is included to accept the personal information about the user. So let's see an example here. You can see in the body, we have created a form. Action is equal to the server, the URL. Then I have included the field set. Field set inside the field set. Field set means we are grouping the form elements. So what elements I am grouping? See, I have created a legend at the top. Legend is basically to show some information to the user that these are the form elements. What is the purpose of collecting these? The purpose of collecting this is to have the contact details about the user. So the legend is suppose contact details, and then I have closed the legend tag. Inside this, a label is created. What it will be shown on the screen? Email address, then break tag, then input type text box is inserted. Text box is inserted here. Then first label is closed, means that text box is inserted for this label email address. Then another text box is inserted for the mobile number. Then third text box is inserted for the telephone. Then when we are over with the related fields, related form elements, then close the field set tag, and I am closing here my form. So when I will save it and open this in the browser, you can see here the legend appears at the top, that is the contact details, and inside it you can see a rectangle is created, a border is created around the related elements. Means these elements of the form are related. Here email address is given, and in the next line break, because I have included break. If you will not include break, so this text box will appear just adjacent to the email address. So I have included break and a text box is appearing. Then the next label is appearing, mobile number, then a text box. The next label, telephone, and the text then the label telephone is appearing, and then the text box. So all these are grouped together. That's why a border is shown here. We can use CSS to modify the size of the grouping fields. Here the rectangle is shown very big. Using CSS, we can reduce its size. And the legend is appearing at the top. So now you have learned how we can group the form elements. You can enter your email address here, your phone number here, then the telephone number, the landline number you can include here. Now we have learned how to create forms, how we can label the forms, how we can group the related fields. Now we will see how we can do the basic validation on the form. Basic validations on the forms, which is basically validation means we can give some information or messages to the user who is filling the form. If the form has been filled correctly or not, if a particular text box is accepting what kind of data. So we can give this information to the user. So let's see an example. Now, let's see here. Inside the body, we have created a form. Action specifies URL. Method attribute specifies what type of method we are using. We are using the post method because this is a very short form. Then a label is created with an attribute for. For, I'm referring to username ID. Okay. Now, you see here, this label will be linked to what? Linked to a form attribute where the ID is username. Where the ID is username. So the label which appears on the screen is username. Then you see we have created an input text box, which is of type, which will accept text. Its name is username and ID is username. This ID will be used to link this particular label. So in for, we are specifying this ID. Now to validate this, that it is a mandatory field, user will not be able to leave this field as empty. What I have written here, required attribute. Required is equals to required in the double quote means that user will not be able to leave this field empty. Similarly, I have created another label, password. And this label is related to which attribute? Password attribute, which I am specifying in my input type is equals to password. Name is password and ID is password here. I'm also specifying the attribute required here in creating the text box. That user will not be able to leave this also as blank. It has to fill the value. Then I have included the third text box. That is your for date, departure date, suppose. Then this is basically related to the username what I am entering. Jo bhi username aap dal rahe ho, jo bhi user ID hai aapka, username ID hai, usi user ka hum departure date le rahe hai. So I have created a label for username, that is attribute is linked with the username ID. So for this user, I am accepting the departure date. Then I have created, this is just look into this, that type is equal to date. So this will accept only date now. Now input type is equal to submit. Type is submit means submit button is added and the button will contain this text value. Whatever value you specify here, this will appear on the button. So when I save this and open it in your browser, so you see here a kind of form is created where I will enter the username, suppose Sakshi, and password. Suppose I skip and I move on to the next field. Any date you can enter here. So a calendar is shown. You can select the date from that and departure date. And I try to submit it. Now it is not allowing me to submit. Why? Because I have validated it. Because I am saying that username and password fields are mandatory. So if I'll try to submit it, it will show me a message. Please fill out this field. I have left this field as empty. So it will ask me to please fill this out. So until and unless I will fill this information, it will not be submitted. It will not allow me to submit the particular form. So now you have learned how we can do the validation, a simple validation. Next, we'll be learning how to add the search input. Like you have seen on the Google homepage, that a search input text box is there where you can add a text box and then you can add the search button. This we can also do. we can also create a form control to accept the email address of the user. So if you want to accept an email address of the user, so you can specify your input tag with the attribute type is equals to email. So that will accept only email. And if you want to accept any website URL, so what you can do, you can specify type is equals to URL in your input tag. Type is equals to URL. If you specify type is equal to email, so you can accept the email from the user. If you specify type is equal to URL, so you can accept any website's URL inside that. Then let's see how we can include. Let me include in this only. Specify input type is equals to search. Type is equals to search. Name could be anything. Let me say the same. Input type is closed. Input tag is closed. Next, I'm specifying input type is equal to submit button. Name is value is equal to submit. Is closed. Now form is closed. So if I save it again. So here you can see you can enter any text inside this, and you can click, since because above fields are mandatory, so it is not allowing me to submit anything. So from this we can select any date. Since because I'm not connected to any valid web page, so it's not working. So at the top, if you see here, I have entered the action as example.com or example.org. You can also use example.net. You can use, this is a dummy web server that you can use for your all activities. Okay.